This excerpt was taken from a Full and Bloom interview with bassist Greg Chaisson. This bonus excerpt has never been published. It's taken from my second interview with Greg. The audio is not great on this. My apologies, but Greg does tell some cool stories.
One of the times for sure when Ratt called me and wanted me to learn all their songs is because they were out with Ozzy, and Sharon Osbourne was trying to steal Juan away from Ratt to put him in Ozzy, because they really liked him on stage, you know, because Juan's pretty energetic on stage.
So I'm assuming Ratt was aware that Ozzy wanted Juan?
Yeah, at that particular juncture they were, because I got a phone call from Robbin, and I don't remember if this was the first or second time they called me. It might have been the first time, saying, hey, Sharon's trying to steal Juan. We're going to need someone. Can you get it together in case this happens? And so I did. Now, that could have been the second time, too. I don't remember, honestly. I just know that the first time I think they called was because they thought Juan was actually going to join us. At the time, Ratt's record was relatively fresh, and it certainly hadn't sold 3 million copies at that point. So, you know, going on the road with Ozzy making $5,000 a week or whatever they were paying, I don't know, probably was more money than Juan was making in Ratt at the time. Now, obviously, staying with Ratt was a good idea because, you know, that record sold over 3 million copies, and the next one sold a couple million, and yada, yada, yada. But sure. At the time, I think it was early on in the touring part of that record, and I think I've never talked to Juan about it, but I think from talking to Robbin then and also Bobby, that they were genuinely concerned that he might actually join Ozzy.
Wow, that's a cool story.
And that may have been the second time, too. I know Bobby and Juan, they have this, well, back even in those days, they had this love-hate relationship where they were a great rhythm section, but they would have their issues. So I don't know how serious anything was on the second time for me to possibly learn the material. That might have been Bobby just being mad at Juan for a week and saying, I'll get Chaisson in the band. So I never actually played with them again. The funny part is they were on tour with Bon Jovi opening. And Robbin called me and said, hey, we want to fly you out to New Mexico. And I wouldn't do anything. So they flew me to Albuquerque, and they were just playing arenas. And so I went to Albuquerque, then I went to Tucson, then I went to Phoenix, and then we flew to Orange County. And so I was with them for about a week and just kind of hanging out. And one of the things they were interested in with me, I found out once I got out there, is they wanted me to be their head of security. The reason I didn't do it is because I was afraid if I did that, that I would just be known as a bodyguard or a security guy when I went to audition for a gig, because even in LA, the community is small. And if I went to audition for a gig, and they said, well, why are we auditioning him? He's, you know, the head of security for Ratt. How's that work? So, because at the time I was Bobby's bodyguard. When we would go out, Bobby would hire me to be his bodyguard. Pearcy had hired me a couple times. A couple times I went out as Bruce Dickinson's bodyguard. So I was kind of known as that guy. And even though I was a musician too, I would go do these gigs mainly because the pay was ridiculously great to go out for a night to drive Bobby around. I could make $300 for just a night's work. Never had to do anything. Only one time in the whole time that I did the whole bodyguard thing did I actually have a confrontation with a guy. And it was out when I was out one night with Bobby and his ex-wife. And as we were going to our seats, we were going to see Kiss. And it was Kiss, and I forget who was opening, I think Vandenberg. And as we were going to our seats, you know, the special seats, as we walked to where the friends of the band sort of thing area was, some guy grabbed Blotzer's wife as we were going up and got kind of fresh with her. So I popped him. Bobby looked at me and said, well, I said, okay. So I friggin' nailed the guy and actually knocked him out. And that was, of all the times I bodyguarded people, that was the only time I ever actually had to hit anyone. So back to my original thing, the time I went out with Ratt for those four shows, one of the things was, hey, we'd like you to be the head of our security. And I was like, nah. And I think they were offering me $1,500 a week, which at that time would have been a lot of money.
Yeah, no doubt. And so how do you feel about that now? Do you wish you would have taken it, or are you glad you didn't?
No, because right around that time, right after that, is when I got the call to audition for Ozzy. And if I had been out on the road with Ratt doing that, I think I probably would have missed out on other things. Now, obviously, I didn't get an assigned band over that period of time. But
yeah, but you met Crosby, you met Jake, though, at that time.
Yeah, it'd be pretty fortuitous for me to meet him.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I've always done that sort of kind of work. I used to be a doorman at strip clubs and at certain rock bars. And then even when Halford, when I first met Halford, when he would go out at night, sometimes he would hire me to just go with him. Because at the time, you know, seeing Bob Halford in Phoenix was a pretty big deal. And so he would just pay me and I would go out. And if anyone got out of line, which they never got out of line, but you know how people can be pretty, you know, they really wanted to meet him and hang out with him and ask him questions. And, you know, if your client is just trying to have a bite for dinner or trying to just be at a bar and have a couple of drinks and chit chat, having five or six guys just all over you or whatever, saying, "Hey man, how did you do the singing on Sad Wings of Destiny? And I really like British Steel," and blah, blah, blah. You know, after a while, you know, hanging out is cool, but after a while, you know, people want their space.
Yeah.
So when I first got to LA, you know, from being friends with Robbin and Bobby, I told them that I had experience doing that as well, not for any other reason, just from passing the time. Hey, I'm telling them about my life. They're telling you about theirs. It wasn't like, "Hey man, if you ever guys ever need a bodyguard," it was just topic of conversation. And then Bobby ended up hiring me. And then that's how that kind of all started.
I think you said that in the interview about, I mean, that's why even you got in Surgical Steel, because you were like one of the tough guys on the block, right?
Well, actually, that's my first band. On Surgical Steel, I got in because they couldn't write any songs and they needed someone to write.
Which band was that?
It was called Ghost Rose. That was the first band I was in. And that's it wasn't called anything at first, but the first, it ended up turning into Ghost Rose. But I have a background in that sort of thing. My father was heavily involved in that. My brother's all boxed. I boxed. I have a martial arts background. That's one of the things that Jake and I kind of had in common, is he also has a martial arts background. And so we could kind of talk about that kind of stuff. And he was interested in boxing. I've done boxing. And it's just part of my life before I became a musician. Like I said, I was kind of like Mr. Super Jock.
Yeah. How tall are you?
Well, now I'm only about 5'10", but, you know, before I became old, I was about 5'11 and a quarter. And I always tell people in my mind, I'm 6'4 and 220.
I grew up in Texas. I mean, we just would get drunk and fight. That was part of my youth, you know. And a lot of people didn't grow up like that. I think it was I always blame it on the heat. The heat does something to you, and I think just pisses everybody off. And it's just in the air in Texas.
Well, my dad couldn't throw a baseball or anything like that, but he could throw a left hand like nobody's business. So his idea was that someday the Great Depression would happen again and people would have to fight for food, because he grew up in the Depression. And so all of us boys, my brother Kenny that played in Tough, and my brother Kirk, and even my brother Todd who played in, or my brother Kenny who played in Keel, and my brother Todd who played in Tough, we all were involved in, you know, we had a boxing ring in our garage, and we had a speed bag and a heavy bag, and that was a very big part of my youth. So I just kind of turned it into a way to make money. It was actually never my intention to do it. It just, at the time, it was the easy way to make money, and if something did happen, then I could deal with it. But like I said, of all the times I did it, I only had to hit one guy one time. Even as a doorman at a bar, I never actually had to hit anyone. I had to take people outside, but I never had to actually square off. Although I was a doorman at a bar here in Phoenix, and a strip bar. And there was one of the dancers, she was a lesbian, and her girlfriend was a big, gigantic lesbian, like 195, 200 pound chick who looked like a middle linebacker for the Packers. And so she showed up at the bar and she was drinking, the girlfriend, and she got kind of jealous about guys putting the dollar bills in the girl's G-string, this and that. So she was causing a ruckus in the bar. And so they took her to the door, and then me and the other doorman took her outside. And when we took her outside, she wanted to fight. She wanted to fight me. And she's pretty big. She had no neck. I mean, her opening words were, "Go ahead, kick me in the balls. I don't have any," she said. You know, that was her thing. "Kick me in the balls. I don't have any." I was thinking, if she throws a punch at me, I'm going to have to defend myself. She's bigger than I am. And if I hit her and I hurt her, then I'm the bad guy. And if I hit her and I bounce one off her chin and she just blinks, then I'm in trouble. Then I would have to hurt her. And so I just told her, I said, hey, look, here's the deal. We can do this if you want. But if we do, you're going to jail and your girlfriend's losing her job. So it's up to you what you want to do. It's your call. And she looked at me and she went, I'm so sorry. And she started crying and she got all emotional and I gave her a hug and she slept it off in her car and that was the end of it. I never talked to her again, but yeah, that was sucked. You can tell that story.